All right, I got a beer. It's a new year, and it's time to come up with some new, great ideas for the channel. I could finally cover that helium beer fake news. Nah, that's not going to be long enough. Oh, I could road trip to Canada and visit Hops and Bros. Oh, wait. I don't have the vacation time with the wedding and all that. Man, it's tough to come up with some good video ideas. Maybe I should just become a beer reviewer. I don't know if I can afford that. Wait. Can I afford that? I don't actually know how much they spend. That's it. I'll try to figure out what the average beer reviewer spends. What could possibly go wrong? Hey everyone, this is Ryan with Beer by the Numbers, and I started this video with a pretty simple question. How much does it cost to review beer here on YouTube? Little did I know that answering this question would be the most intensive research project I've ever undertook for this channel. For this one single video, I spent hour upon hour logging literally thousands of beers being reviewed on YouTube into a database so I could use my number crunching skills to analyze all these videos for pricing and style trends. But that was just the start, as the results I got led me down the crazy rabbit hole of topics including crazy quirks of beer culture, why diversity in craft beer is such a difficult goal, and the strange world of YouTube economics. If you're ready to get really hands-on with some data and maybe discover the keys to success of a beer channel here on YouTube, leave a like down below and let's get started. Before we get into how I calculated how much beer reviewers spent here on YouTube, let's talk about YouTube itself a bit first. YouTube has gone from a website where a small community of random people uploaded crappy videos of cats and obscure jokes and transformed into a giant corporate entity featuring high production value videos that generates billions of dollars worth of ads and is not so subtly attempting to displace television in the minds of America's younger generations. The premise of the website has always been brilliantly simple. With a computer and a camera, you can get your video in front of millions of people without having to please a TV exec or spend thousands of dollars or even have any video production skills in the first place. But if you just grab your camera and start filming yourself enjoying a few beers, you'll quickly find out that you're probably not getting a lot of views, and you're definitely not rolling in that YouTube celebrity money those ridiculous vloggers and video gamers are getting. What gives? Well, in order to get people to watch your video, they have to be able to find it first. And the main way that happens here on YouTube is through suggested videos. And the method by which YouTube chooses videos to suggest is done via the algorithm. YouTube uses an algorithm to determine how popular a video is and how similar it is to videos you've already watched to find other videos to suggest for you to watch next. This tends to be a never-ending source of frustration for content creators as YouTube constantly tweaks this algorithm to maximize the amount of times people spend on the site. You can find a ton of videos on the algorithm from creators and how to optimize your videos to get more attention, but it usually boils down to this. The more watch time your videos get, the more eyeballs YouTube is going to send its way. This means that for beer channels, in order to get even a small glance from the algorithm gods, you probably need to upload at least one video a week or have longer 20 plus minute reviews to keep your watch time stats up. But as we'll see in a bit, the BeerTube community is a lot more dedicated than just that basic goal. Another thing to note about YouTube is the noticeable production quality increases in videos since the site began. When the site first started, it was just a webcam and an internet connection. No real scripting or editing or zippy graphics were needed. But today, the site is full of wonderfully produced videos that bring together teams of writers, editors, and actors, all to make amazing content. Although no beer review channel is quite on the corporate media level, some are still very well edited. Take A Beer in Review, for example. His videos are well organized into a nice format, they're edited, and they are given some nice graphics and a theme song. Contrast that with the review style of Tanya Makowski, who takes a very unstructured but interesting approach to beer reviews, all with a simple webcam. Both these styles can really work, but it's really up to the reviewer to bring a lot of personality to make a compelling video. That being said, I don't think I'm going to try to account for costs like editing software, microphones, and cameras, or time spent scripting and editing, as I try to determine how much being a beer reviewer costs. Besides having a ton of variables when it comes to prices of software and camera, I think great tools are a nice-to-have thing, but not a requirement to run a great beer review channel. I'm really just looking at what each beer in a video costs. Speaking of what each video costs, let's talk about the methodology I'm using to determine how much it costs to be a beer reviewer. To start, let's talk about what channels I'm counting as a beer review channel in the first place. Not to brag, but I think I have the most complete listing of beer-related channels here on YouTube. I'm subscribed to over 250 beer channels. If you run a beer channel on YouTube and have uploaded a video in the last 3 months, there is a 95% chance I'm subscribed to you. So I think I have a pretty good handle on the total population size of beer reviewers here on YouTube. So which beer channels are being left out? Well, first, my homebrewing friends are sadly being left out of this one. Although my buddies like Drunken One and 8-Bit Chicken do some great beer reviews, they have so much homebrewing content that I can't estimate the prices of. I really can't include them as part of my survey group. Second, I'm looking for reviewers that upload content consistently. Now, that doesn't have to be every week, but at least every 2 months throughout the year 2018. This isn't really a problem at all for most channels, as they are all striving to meet the algorithm's ever-shifting content requirements. Finally, if your videos didn't include the beer name in the title of the video, I'm sorry, but I just wasn't able to log the beer into my database. As we'll soon see, just looking at video titles took way more time than I initially anticipated. So now that we have a pool of YouTube channels to look at, it's time to randomly select a sample for our research. I'm subscribed to 237 channels that I would classify primarily as beer review channels. I wanted to get at least about a 15% sample size, so I assigned each a number and had a random number generator pick me out 35 channels. And then I began logging what beers they were reviewing. Uh-oh, I may have bit off a bit more than I can chew. This is Dean's Beer Reviews, and in 2018, Dean gave the beer world 169 beer reviews. That's a new video almost every 2 days, which is a crazy rate to be churning out videos that teams of professional video makers barely manage to accomplish with corporate money backing. Dean had the most video reviews in the year of 2018 of the 35 randomly selected channels I reviewed. Only 3 channels even managed to break triple digits, so 169 reviews is quite the accomplishment. Now, logging all the beers and breweries from Dean's beer reviews took me a little over an hour. Great, only 34 channels to go. This is fine. I'm fine. This is fine. I'm fine. It's fine. This is fine. Yeah, just reading and logging video titles took me a little under 13 hours, but I ended up with a great data set of 2,127 reviews from 35 channels in 2018. Wow. But then another realization hit me. I was only halfway done getting my data. Now I had to go find a price estimate for each one of these beers. Guys, I really want to stress here how dumb of an idea this ended up being. I ended up Googling 2,000 unique beers looking for pricing data. You know, there were easy beers like Budweiser or breweries like Founders that include suggested retail prices on their websites. But for bombers or limited release beers, websites like Total Wine, the LCBO, or Tesco helped me get a cost for almost every beer on the list. For the 100 or so limited release beers, I spent hours tracking them down on forums or trading sites, and if that still didn't help, I had to just give them their style average price. All in all, this was 24 plus hours of logging, price checks, delving into forums, and drinking a lot of coffee beer, but I finally had it. A 2,000 plus line database of beers, styles, breweries, and prices. A data set that a beer nerd like me could only dream of. So now, it's finally time for me to combine my financial analyst day job skills with my obsession with beer to analyze this huge data set to get answers to all my questions about beer reviews and see how viable it is to learn and cool insights about the beer community at large. Can you tell I'm a little excited? So, I have a ton of insights to share with you based on this data, but let's not beat around the bush anymore. How much will an average year of beer reviews cost you, the aspiring beer reviewer seeking some internet fame? Well, the 35 channel average was 34 beer reviews in 2018, and the average total spend on beer was $237. This means the average beer cost per video was just under $7. Now, $7 review seems a little high to me, but the average total cost of $237 actually seemed pretty reasonable. But the 34 reviews a year surprised me a little bit. As we already covered, it's generally important to be cranking out about a video a week to appease the algorithm gods. So why don't we take a look at how many channels are reviewing, say, 50 beers a year and what kind of costs they're incurring. So of the 35 channels I sampled, about half had more than 50 reviews in 2018. Looking at the average cost for these reviewers, they spent about $375. Definitely a little steeper price tag when it comes to making YouTube content. It seems that reviewing beer on YouTube is a little more expensive than something like video gaming, where you can get hours upon hours of content out of a single game. But if you're a numbers person like me, you definitely want to look and see all the crazy outliers. We already discussed Dean's Beer Reviews, who had a rocket 169 reviews in 2018, but in a close second and third, we had Craft Beer Pours with 155 reviews and Kent Beer Reviews with 154 reviews, all in a single year. I estimate each of these reviewers spent over $500 on beers to review, but Dean kept the top spot with an estimated of $590 put towards beer reviews. Speaking of beers being reviewed, let's talk about the most popular styles, breweries, and maybe some of the least expensive beers being reviewed. I'll give you one guess right now as to what the most popular beer style being reviewed in 2018 was. Go ahead, I'll give you a second. If you guessed IPAs, you are absolutely right, and it's really no wonder. Most hardcore beer nerds love a good IPA, so it's not a surprise that these folks who love beer enough to film themselves are drawn towards IPAs. 724 of the 2,100 plus beers reviewed were IPAs, meaning that this single style dominated just over a third of all beer reviews on YouTube. I think it would be really neat to see how many craft beers being brewed are IPAs to see if the style is over or underrepresented in the beer review community. Alas, I don't have such a comprehensive list, but I wouldn't be surprised if a quarter or maybe even a third of craft beers being brewed in the US are IPAs. In second place, with 14% of beers reviewed, were stouts, and this isn't really a huge surprise either. Hardcore beer lovers are always talking about the latest big, heavy stout they have, and because of their big reputations, they actually make great conversation starters, which is probably why they are so well represented in beer reviews. No matter what part of the country a beer lover is in, I can usually connect with them by talking about Bourbon Street or Founders KBS, and that works great here on YouTube. Stouts also represented the most expensive style on average, costing nearly $8 a review. And this makes total sense, because not only are stouts kind of expensive to produce, but many are only available in bomber formats, which have a much higher average price tag than a 12 or 16 ounce beer. And a stout was also the most expensive beer in my dataset as well. Sofa King Drunk 66 broke out an old bottle of BrewDog's Tactical Nuclear Penguin, one of the strongest and most expensive beers ever produced by those crazy Scottish brewers. This beer trades on secondary markets today for anywhere from $130 to $180, so it was actually a real treat to see it reviewed here on YouTube. The next two most popular styles for reviews are pale ales and New England IPAs. Again, two hoppier styles that are very popular amongst US brewers. Speaking of brewers, which breweries were turning out the beers that reviewers wanted to get their hands on the most? Believe it or not, this group of hardcore beer nerds actually turned to Budweiser beers more than any other brewery in 2018. Now, you might be a little confused by this, but Budweiser did release a couple of new products that really kind of captured the attention of the beer community, and apparently inspired reviews from over a third of our reviewer sample group. They were Bud Light Orange and Budweiser Copper Lager, featuring those Jim Beam barrels. Not only were these beers really widely available, but come on, how could you not be curious as to how bad Bud Light Orange is? In second, there was a tie between Guinness and Founders. Guinness released its cool 200th anniversary stout, which makes a great story and a nice thing to reflect on within a beer review. And Founders just makes great beer and is widely available in the US. I know they are always a solid choice when I see them on tap or in the local bottle shop. No one beer dominated reviews from Founders. A lot of their portfolio was covered. The Great Breakfast Stouts, Dankwood IPA, and their macro killer, the Solid Gold Lager, were all great choices for reviewers. So I guess I've kinda answered my initial question, and a whole lot more. But to be a beer reviewer on YouTube, it costs anywhere from $230 to almost $600 a year in beer alone. But aside from that data, I think the results also allow us to draw some pretty interesting conclusions. First, it's very difficult to break even when it comes to recouping your beer costs via YouTube ad revenue as a reviewer. There are plenty of videos on all the changes YouTube has made to their monetization policies over the past 2 years, but long story short, it's becoming more difficult for small and independent creators to make any money via YouTube at all, much less earn back the cost of their beer. My channel is pretty small by YouTube standards, but for the small subset of channels focused on beer, I have one of the larger followings. I was only just approved for monetization a couple months ago, and without going into too much detail, it would be tough for me to make $300 to $600 in a year on YouTube or ad revenue. The unfortunate reality is that 90%+ of beer reviewers online are probably only doing it for the passion. And while there's certainly nothing wrong with that, it does say something about how hard it is to stand out and make a little cash on the side in this era of mass independent media. But beyond the videos themselves, I can't help but wonder if a bias towards IPAs and stouts limits the viewership of beer videos just a bit. I know the most likely fans of beer reviews probably really enjoy IPAs and stouts, but this might just cast a bit narrow of a net. I know new craft beer fans usually don't start with a crazy hoppy IPA or a $20 stout bomber, so I think there is a major opportunity to welcome in more viewers if beer reviewers expanded their horizons a bit. Amber ales and lagers, I think, capture a lot of new drinkers' interests, and for me personally, I love a good Saison, and would definitely selfishly love to see more reviews of those. Aside from the hundreds of dollars in monetary costs, I also wonder a bit about the health costs beer reviewers are paying. I know from personal experience that there is quite a bit of pressure to get another video filmed, edited, and posted to keep my channel on a good growth trajectory, and I'm sure beer reviewers feel that same pressure as well. Drinking several extra beers a week to keep the YouTube algorithm happy probably adds quite a few extra calories, and beer nerds are already known to have a quite substantial diet of liquid bread. This is a theme I've heard from several different beer reviewers as they talk about how they're trying to balance weight loss and health goals while trying to keep up with their channel. Some reviewers have been much more successful than others at maintaining that balance, and I'd like to think they'd serve as good role models for the larger beer community, which generally struggles with some health consequences as a result of strong passion for great beer. Finally, I'll be covering this in a future video, but the data I got indicated it can be a bit expensive to be a beer nerd. Compared to other hobbies or interests, drinking a lot of craft beers is pretty pricey, making this community almost exclusively made up of people in the middle class or higher. This can be a challenge for craft beer diversity initiatives, as many people craft beer would like to expand its appeal to might not be able to afford the product. Again, this is something I'm going to be covering in a future video, but for now, I think cost is a big factor that craft brewers and beer fans need to consider. The beer review community here on YouTube is a great one, and I'm so happy every time another cool beer or great personality pops into my video feed. Although it can be a little expensive to review beers, it's something that's largely attainable if you're doing reviews for the passion of craft beer, rather than to make bundles of money. I want to thank all the great beer reviewers out there, and the other beer channels here on YouTube as well, for the endless hours of entertainment you have provided me. I know it comes with a sizable personal cost, but thank you all for sharing your passion with us. If you're a beer reviewer or just a beer fan, please let me know what you thought of this data and my conclusions in the comments section below. I covered a lot, from beers and brewers to the economics of independent media and beer culture in general, and I would love to hear your thoughts, especially if you think I'm wrong. And this video is a little different from what I've done in the past, so if you're a regular here on Beer by the Numbers, let me know what you think of the new format as well. Once again, this has been Ryan with Beer by the Numbers, and I'll see you next time with some more over-researched beer content.